player.
And with that, we are just about ready to get into champion select for game number three. Back to 1-1 between the two. Once again, we'll say goodbye to Rusty for this game, but we'll see him in the analyst desk shortly thereafter. Jace is going to be the ban, as EDG have opted to start on blue side for this one. Game Talents immediately ban that LeBlanc. As Rusty said, it is that red side ban.
Yeah, so GT have banned LeBlanc consistently. That's just something they go towards, I guess. So overall, they respect the pick a lot. They don't want it in scouts' hands. So the top three bans, usually they should go through fairly quickly. The one big thing is that I think EDG should be banning the Camille here because and third ban, because Game Talents actually do like to leave it open. That's the point I wanted to make a little earlier on. So that could be a possibility. No, they're just actually, This is going to be the first point that they actually look to ban it here. So
the jungle for Wu Shuang we talked about potentially being a point of focus for Game Talents. So far, there hasn't been Rengar or Kha'Zix touched by either EDG or Game Talents. And we've already seen Lee Sin picked up by Fire Lolly. So we'll have to see if they decide to focus that down, because if they do, then that means that perhaps Syndra could get through, perhaps that Ryze could get through. But there is going to be the Kha'Zix ban for Wu Shuang.
Yeah, so Wu Shuang was... You know, he played that Kha'Zix really well in the first game round, so the EDG is respecting it, want to take it away. They're not going to look towards first picking it here, especially with Varus still open. It's going to be interesting to see if EDG goes towards that Varus pick or the Zyra pick. It should be Varus. Ryze is still available, actually, so it could be easily between Ryze and Varus. It looks like they're just going to go back to that pick here.
Yeah, the Varus worked really well for Zett in game number one. Significant amounts of damage, landing arrow after arrow, but that means that the Ryze slips through to Game Talents, and they have the option of going for that jungle priority if they so choose at this point, but support pool still wide open, and we haven't even talked about the top laners yet.
Yeah, so it kind of feels like game one already. This is actually just a big point where GT are going with what's comfortable to them. They will 100% look to hold that mid lane, that top lane pick towards the second point of the draft. Wu Shuang's on the Lee Sin, so that's the big change, obviously, because the Kha'Zix was banned out, so they're going to give him the good champion, so Lee Sin and Lee Sin are likely just going to be traded out here.
Yeah, Lee Sin, as you said, from Wu Shuang, and the Elise traded it back over. Immediately, Poppy picked up from Mouse. Maokai still made it through.
Ooh.
Game Talents could try not to show anything by taking that, or they could look for something else.
This is going to be really tricky here, because Elise plus Poppy means that Elise's pressure is going to actually be towards mid lane and bottom lane. If I'm Game Talents here, Syndra is going to be the biggest point, because Game Talents are going to be looking for it. So if you're Game Talents, you already have your mid lane pick. You want to ban out Syndra in your first, in your second phase of bans here.
Let's see if they are going to try to target Scout. So far, it's a bottom focus. Zyra is the ban.
They still have a ban left. I have faith.
Yeah. They're going to end up banning Misfortune next. Just watch. Ashe is the follow-up from EDG. Game Talents, are they going to make the right choice here?
Game Talents might actually just look to ban out the Misfortune here and make it so the Malzahar is just uncontested as a pick, and will have like a strong lane. Yeah, actually, it's the Orianna, funny enough. So they're just trying to make the laning phase easier for Gimgun and the laning phase easier for Malzahar. It's going to be harder because now EDG naturally will just go towards the Syndra. And even though Ryze should be fairly comfortable, it's once again, you put yourself in a position where you're against Syndra and Elise.
Certainly a dangerous combo if they manage to pair up, but Jhin is the AD carry for Zubin to try dealing with that Varus, and Syndra is now locked in for Scout. Republic's going to have to answer back from his performance in the previous game.
It's going to be interesting to see EDG pick up. I think they'll go for a Talmkench. It's actually going to be a... it looks like it's going to be the Misfortune. The big point here is that if they went for the Talmkench, it would have been easier for EDG to play around the map. Syndra would have had a little bit more safety as well as Mouse. And on top of that, you would have had the extra frontline pressure with Poppy and Talmkench. Now it's just going to be all Poppy to be that frontline. It's going to be solely on his shoulder. So if he falls behind early with a bad matchup, nah, it looks like Game Goon's just going to go towards the Maokai. But if it was a bad matchup... then Scout would have been a little bit, or at least EDG would have been in a tough spot in the later game team fights.
And the Maokai is going to time out and be locked in for Game Talents, this time a composition that they have chosen completely. and not made any slip-ups on. Taking a look at it, is this something that they can run at EDG? Gimgoon going to have a little bit more difficulty rushing in through the front like he did in game number one with that Kled that he had.
So my big focus here is going to be in the bottom lane, funny enough, because EDG, once again, they have a really good lane in terms of just pressure. They're going to constantly look to pressure out Sivoki and Subin. And Subin's on the Jhin, which is a new pick that we've seen here. And he's just going to take it. It's just going to be so hard for him to actually have any pressure here. Varus does incredibly well into the Jhin because Jhin's auto range is pretty low. And he has to actually Q. If he walks into Q range as well, it's like it's incredibly low and predictable. So then the poke coming in from Varus is very easy to land.
Yeah, Zett had a huge performance in game number one on that Varus, despite the fact that they'd ended up losing. This time, however, he will have Lee Sin diving onto him, along with a Ryze and Malzahar, versus Wu Shuang on that Kha'Zix and the Kled coming in from the front. So perhaps a little bit more opportunity, and he's got a Poppy on his side to just knock people away. So it might be EDG looking to play towards that side as well as game talents.
The thing about the Maokai here is the... Because just piggybacking off your point here in the Poppy top lane, Poppy does get pushed in just a little bit. So he's going to have a little bit of a tough time in terms of controlling the wave clear that Maokai does have early on. So that's a bit of a takeaway. With that being said, Courage of the Colossus is still a big point here. So we might just see Poppy look to trade out. Poppy with Courage of the Colossus trades incredibly well. So perhaps... that just might not go in Gimgoon's favor. But it's trade versus wave clear. Gimgoon should be fairly confident just clearing out and allowing Wushuang to have full top side control. I just think from the composition we're seeing from Game Talents, their focus is going to be bottom lane. They are going to get shoved in constantly, but they have Malzahar, they have Jhin. That's a lot of level 6 spike here. And if top lane Maokai can get the shove in and have a lot of free time, that TP is going to be coming in. Lee Sin's going to be looking to get something off too. And Ryze, if he is free... And he will be free. You'll be able to shove in mid quite a bit. That's something to watch out for if you're EDG.
It certainly is. We'll keep an eye on that matchup over the course of it. Perhaps Fire Lolly could try to repeat his performance from game number two on this Elise and influence Gimgoon very early, influence Mouse's matchup to set him up for success. As the defensive line is set across the Rift, Game Talents. Currently, not a single match win to their name so far this year. And again, it is only win two. They've set themselves up. They took game number one and then immediately tossed it right back out to the fishes with a mistake in the pick and ban for game number two. Now they're trying to answer back here in game number three and show that, yes, they can compete with the best.
You know, here's the thing. Even if they lose this game, and you know what? They don't want to lose, obviously, so we're just into this game. But it's already such a massive... big ups for this team. This is a massive improvement where in the first week they just crumbled in the early game, and they actually just in both games, in game two, game one and game two against Chaozu, could not match up to them. This time around it looks like they're really well in tuned, especially specifically in the first game. Let's just hope that their laning phases work out as Steven just get a little bit closer.
Yeah, this is the exact same combo that we saw in game number one. Make it rain, and then immediately while target in the Make It Rain was slowed, dropping out that piercing arrow. And again, Subin!
This is the hardest lane. It's a really hard lane.
Yeah, he was below 200 health there.
What makes it hard is that there are too many points in this lane that slows you. So, for instance, you did mention the Make It Rain, but also the Hail of Arrows. Because of how short range Subin is on Jhin, if he walks up, he is going to be in Hail of Arrows range, which is a slow. Which is on top of another slow coming in from Misfortune, and you're just going to keep getting poked down.
Yeah, Zett is just nailing these arrows over and over. Mako pulls the bouncing grenade away. And again, just burning through those potions. He did start Longsword with some health potions, so he has got some relatively high effective HP if he continues to burn through them.
Yeah, he can. Jhin does have a lot of... sustain off of the potions, as you mentioned, that he can just continuously... He's already used all of his potions, so that's hilarious. But he just doesn't have the HP and the life on hit that brings from the Doran's Blade. So now that he's in this point, he has to play super patiently. A big focus is going to be on Fire Lolly if he does join the fight here, because it's an easy fight to join. Zubin just has to survive. I mean, we mentioned it. Level 6 is the point where he can actually do something, where his team can actually help him out. But if he can't get to that point, that's going to be a big loss for Game Talents here.
Taking a look at the junglers right now. Wushuang and Fire Lolly both cleared out their bottom side, and Fire Lolly gets there just a bit faster because he decided to cut through the mid lane. Gets a ward down as Zet is going to help clear out these minions with Mako.
And the ward that that's being placed right now, or at least has been placed for EDG on the top side of the map, just makes it so Lee Sin actually doesn't have a way to impact mid lane from top side. So he can't walk towards the top side Tri-Bush. Poppy had that warded. And he can't walk through his Raptors camp because that got warded by Elise as well. So Syndra is super safe because of these essentially soft wards into the jungle, which means that if Lee Sin's going to get a gank off, it's going to be on the bottom side. But he can't even do that because the ward's also been placed there by Syndra. So
yeah,
really good control coming in from EDG to help scout out.
So it is still very early. It's barely 4.5 minutes in, but already EDG are 500 gold ahead as all three lanes are opening up an advantage over their opponents. Republic going for his recall right now. He's going to miss a few minions unless he's forced to stay as the recall is canceled.
This happens a lot. I mean, get out of it. Here we go.
That's exhaust being used. Fire Lolly's down there as well.
And he didn't. That's just a straight trade. Game one, we saw them trade out exhaust. This time around, it's legitimately just only Sivoki using exhaust here. Fire Lolly, as I mentioned, he's clued in, he's watching, and he's bringing in scouts. So this is just going to be a full committal.
Does the ward see? No, it does not see Zubin. Savoki's still there, however. They see Sivoki, and now they see Fire Lolly as well. Moby boots with that first recall.
That was really a good early flash from Sivoki because 100% Fire Lolly will flash in first. And on top of that, the minion wave actually saved him. So he flashed into a minion wave, so there was no way Fire Lolly was going to be able to flash and get the cocoon off. Yeah, this is just constant pressure. It didn't turn into a kill, but it's turning into outright tower damage 5 minutes into the game. And of course, Ryze is just trying to find any way to back. This is just an outright win for
EDG.
Please
let me get my tier.
Anytime.
I just want to start stacking. Speaking of tiers, Zet will pick up his own along with three longswords. The serrated dirk is completed for Zubin. And we're starting to see Zubin like, I need gold. Push the wave back. 20 CS down 6 minutes in due to the pressure from that combo.
He's trying his hardest to get this shoved in. So this is a problem because once Varus gets to the lane, he can actually start to shove out as much as possible and maybe even get a little bit more damage onto that tower while Jin is behind. It's not going to be a big problem. I think right here, Zet, his main focus is his last day, and hopefully with the wave coming in, he can actually hold the wave and make it a longer lane for Jin to farm up against. So yeah, there we go. That's actually kind of it's not even kind of impressive. That's just rude.
Mm-hmm. Oh man, Zubin, he's not too happy about this. So close to level 6, he said, just wait till you get level 6, then the rest of the team will be able to make something happen. EDG are already disabling that as well. Control ward in the river, along with a ward in the pixel bush to keep an eye on whenever Wushuang or Republic gets down there.
So this is going to be a big point for EDG because they're slow pushing it. Essentially, the wave will get larger and larger. Ah, just kidding. That wave, Zet actually, even though he poked him out, he cleared out the entire backline. So that's actually just going to be fast pushing in. So a little bit of an unintended point, but that, you know, he got the poke. That's all he really wanted.
Blue buff now going to be gifted over to Scout, who will once again receive it faster than Republic because Fire Lolly is on this blue side now. And you can see Wushuang just a little bit too slow in the river, scouting around from behind. Control ward is going to deny Scout's vision of that top side of the mid lane, so Scout just plays it back to his turret and stays safe. Wushuang might be looking for some action to Mouse, who is level 6, as Gimgun goes aggressive. Ward hops over the wall, Sonic Wave hits, and there's the aura denying Wushuang.
Oh, he got a try. You know, he made the attempt, and it didn't work out well for him, but that's a bad... Like, he tried the gank, and that's not... You know, I'll give him that. But the problem is, he should have been bottom side. This is the real pressure point here that he needs to look towards. Especially, sure, Zubin's not at level 6. He's actually at level 5, but if you can help him to that point, that's all you really want. That just means that they're going to lose this tower. That's an assurance.
Fire Lolly and Scout collapsed after they saw Zubin recall, and they will invade the blue buff, stealing it away, taking that first turret of gold. Mouse trying to hit Gim Goon, actually clears the minions out.
Yep.
Despite the fact that Republic is there as well, Wu Shang is going to stall it out. Who's going to be the
tank? That's not
going to
work.
Looks like it's Gim Goon. He takes the first hit, stalls it out. Mouse doesn't have flash. First blood goes down. Republic drops, but gets executed. So that's first blood to Game Talents. They're going to try to answer back with the turret, but Savoki, he used his flash earlier. That's the bullet time. Savoki finally drops. Zet eats a lot of damage and answer. Exhaust denies. Zubin exhaust tries to stop the crit. They both flash! And EDG pick up two kills as Zet and Mako are just outplaying this bottom lane.
Legitimately just outclassing them. So that was just the pressure point. They recognized that Lee Sin's top side. So, you know what? Mouse, even though he couldn't get the kill, he still got the execution. That's fine. He survived long enough for Ryze to actually tank out that completely. So overall, Mouse did his job. He was just trying to hold them back as much as possible, so he had full faith in EDG in the bottom side. And that's faith for you. Right now, EDG are cleaning house here.
Yeah.
Game Talents
wanted this composition, right? They picked into this. And yet, we're still seeing a similar performance from EDG as their game number two. It just seems like a completely different EDG when they turn it on.
It just feels like, for me, it's the same in the sense that Zet and Mako have just shown themselves to be a really good bottom lane. That's just an assured point. They're playing incredibly well, and they're outclassing Game Talents without the Varus, and now this is the second game that they're able to get Varus, because the second game, game two,
it was banned.
So overall, it doesn't matter what lane they get, they just seem to be continuously pressuring them down.
Game Talents are invading the red buff out of EDG, as the lane swap predicted by Game Talents is something that actually happens. Zet and Mako head towards that top side while Mouse heads on down to the tier one. He's hanging back just in case. Didn't quite know where that Lee Sin or the Ryze was, so he just wanted to play safe and not have to waste his flash in an attempted outplay. Mm-hmm. But as it turns out, lane swap is called and met. Zubin goes top to try to answer as Yomuz gets Zet away.
Yeah,
they don't have a turret to fall back to.
Mm-hmm. So this has just been a bit of a theme. Even though the turret has died, and Zet and Mako are a bit of a long lane, they should be fairly safe in the sense that Firelolly's in the area. Oh,
Goon actually catches Republic. There's the cleanse. Chain of Corruption goes the wrong direction. Teleport is activated and canceled by Gim Goon.
Yeah, you have to cancel it. So that's a big point. Firelolly, or at least the entirety of EDG, can get just go back to that point. Savoki gets cut out.
That's a lot of damage. They're going to try burning him down. And the Unleashed Power, a little bit excessive.
Yeah, I didn't have to use that. But now Zubin's like, all right, you know what? They did that to him. Yeah, I got to get out of here.
Don't worry. I'll tell everybody else about your sacrifice.
A bit of a martyr. Remember the name, Savoki.
Yes, remember the 5th of February.
There we go.
It's the 10th.
I actually watched, so this is a bit of an off point, but I did watch V for Vendetta fairly recently. And I love the movie. I mean, everybody loved the movie, but I just only recently. So I'm a bit slow to the point. Slow to the punch.
Scout here.
Oh!
Trying to go for the same outplay that V did at the end of the film. Gets kicked over the wall, and Republic just walks it up, flashes over, but finds himself in the curtain call. Dodges one, gets hit by the second, and Republic cleans up the third, just like in the movie.
There we go.
He gets shot.
That's good. I like that. I appreciated that one. Oh, but overall, I think that was, even though there was a bit of a miscommunication with Lee Sin kicking him over the wall and Rags, like, I was going to take that teleport. I was there, shutting him off. But it works out. They were able to get the kill. That was just a really good point that right now Game Talents has to continuously go back to. They need to look to upset the tempo that EDG are currently setting because, top tower is already down. We didn't even talk about it because of what was happening in the mid lane.
All that excitement was going on.
Yeah, so EDG are just playing a constant game saying, we're going by the formula here. We took down bot tower. We took down top tower. We're going to look to take down mid. They're just like constantly looking for your tower. So even though Game Talents are looking for these picks don't really get you the continuous gold here. Unless if you can continuously find yourself to get more kills. So
it seems like EDG are saying turrets get you gold. Denying your enemy CS gets you comparative gold. It's 4,000 gold ahead as we get towards that 13-minute mark. Zet now in the mid lane, finishing the Yomu and picking up a second serrated Dirk for himself, while Zubin has not even finished his Yomus. Republic showing that he can sidestep, however, as he dodges a spell. Still no Rod of Ages as we get towards that 13-minute mark. Mountain Drake. Looks like it is going to be spawning soon as Game Talents are setting up for it.
The one big point I'm going to mention, Let's see. So 60 CS, I would say that right now Zed is over Zubin.
Approximately.
Zubin's just trying to find a way to farm. And the only way he can farm is in the mid lane, but looks like there's a bit of action happening here. He can't find that peace and quiet.
Yeah, even in that scenario, Zet, Mako, and Fire Lolly were just keeping the wave pinned, and despite four members of Game Town showing up and trying to break it, they could not find a kill. Mm-hmm. Though it looks like EDG might be the ones to look for a kill as they shove the minion wave in the top lane, bringing in that cannon wave.
Yeah, it's a cannon minion, as you mentioned, so this is going to be an easy one to look to pressure out. They're recognizing that GT are now rotating. They could have probably put a little bit more pressure onto it since they're a bit slow to that rotation. But overall, EDG, they're fast, they're moving, they recognize what their play is. This is just a really good game so far from EDG.
Mm-hmm. Very clean performance. I think this is much closer to the game that most people were expecting in game number one. Not for Game Talents to be matching the over-aggression of EDG, capitalizing and taking kills, and then trading turrets back around. Mm-hmm. But this time, as you said, EDG much more patient, not making those mistakes.
Exactly. I mean, EDG right now, as you mentioned, they're more patient. And look at the Savoki and Nushong are just sitting here, but that's not going to work. There's no reason for them to come towards that direction. I mean, Game Talents recognize, look, we set up towards Dragon. They have to come towards Dragon. It's a Earth Dragon that's going to be very valuable, so they're looking for the pick. It's going to be up to EDG to say.
Mako.
Oh, here we go.
Oh, no, Mako.
Oh, no.
Gets the sweeper, but is still going to get caught out. Flashes very unnecessarily.
That was a good sweeper overall. He recognized that the possibility
like,
existed.
There's definitely somebody in this bush. I'm going to sweep it. Yep, I knew it.
Yeah, he couldn't react to it. So he kind of did it as a formality because he sweeped it, but was still walking in that direction rather than playing safe. So as the sweeper went on, if he was actually, he stopped still. He did have flash still. He did still had exhaust. He would have been able to react to it. But just as a general point, that was just a free pick from Game Talents because they recognized the objective was coming up.
Yeah, they might be looking for another pick here as they are grouped as four around that Mountain Drake. Looks like Mouse has got his teleport, though there are a few wards on the side that he could look towards. Republic is not there.
Yeah, so that's the big point there. Game Talents have to walk away or at least respect it because they don't have the numbers. Ryze was topside clearing up against Poppy. So that just means if he's going to be in range, that means he has to be in ulti range. And ulti range, especially level 1 ulti range, not good enough.
Indeed, it is not. The Realm Warp, he's finally level 11 now, so he can get the level 2 Realm Warp. Scout chases up along with Mako and Fire Lolly. There's no turret, but there is Wushuang waiting in the try in the back. But instead, EDG just play it safe and reclaim control over that Drake. Lots of wards going down, lots of vision.
Here we go.
Oh, Scout is caught.
Oh.
Knocks Wushuang back right as he eats the dragon kick and looks for the solo kill and finds it.
That was actually really well played from Scout. I mean, that's an obvious point, but he was able to cancel out the Q that was coming in.
Yeah.
So Lee Sin, even though he couldn't get on top of him to follow up any of that damage, he just kicked him away and got canceled on his Q. So overall, Scout's like, I just have a range advantage. You're dead.
Yeah, timing the scatter the weak with the dragon kick to buffer both stuns.
Really well played. Overall, EDG just have control over Dragon. They regain control, and Game Talents are trying anything to actually get that lead, be it skirmishes. It looks actually like they're just trying to find any possible skirmishes. It's just not working out for them.
Game Talents now trying to defend their tier 2 turret as EDG send three members to pressure it forward. Scout with a recall, finishing off that Morellos. And now picking up the main components for his Rabadon's death cap. If he wants to go for the classic, I'm going to kill you build.
Yep, that's the way to do it.
Yeah.
Especially since you don't have to land anything on Zubin to kill him.
Yeah, you just press R.
Yeah, it's not going to. He is so far behind right now. It is a little upsetting. So
it's not gotten too much worse. It's still only 65. It could be like 70 or 80.
Could always get worse. That's a positive mentality. A better mentality would just to get to be better, to get become a better player. It's a hard lane.
It's a hard thing to do in the middle of a game 3.
Yeah, I suppose.
Against EDG when you're already down about 4,000 gold.
One thing I do love from EDG here with their lead is that they keep pressuring every lane. There's actually just no lane moving against them. So Scout's moving up the top lane, giving that dog a walk there. Bottom lane, Poppy's constantly shoving out, so Maokai has to match. Right now, They're going to be looking to set up off this wave coming here. I think it's a cannon minion. Where are you? Nah, it's not a cannon creep. So it's not that good, but they can still do it simply because Maokai, Ryze are not in the area. And honestly, Wushuang is late to the punch, so they actually just lose this tower outright because Wushuang was farming up the Krugs here. Okay, no, it's not going to happen. They still respect them.
You know, EDG are just playing the patient game. You know, that's what we talked about a little bit in the previous match was, yes, they have a very strong advantage. Yes, they can continue to look for picks, but the big thing is they're not risking anything, really.
Yeah, they're just doing off the smart wave. I think this is a cannon creep as well, so I'm going to be, nah, just, you know what, just kidding. It's not happening. No cannon creeps at all.
Oh, Wushuang tries to collapse. Ooh. Cocoon lands, and he gets destroyed as Mouse gets in there. Gimgoon hops over the far side, but EDG are moving in the opposite direction. Scout gets left behind. Republic, once again, with the creative flank. Scout will drop. Mako drops as well. Cocoon gets dodged by Republic, who's playing remarkably well. Flashes to chase Fire Loli out. That means he's got to turn onto Mouse. Zet is still on the side, but cannot find a way in as Mouse is buying time. He's got to try to do something. Fire Loli looks for an opening, but does not find it. And that's Zet forced to flash away from Gimgoon. Game talents win the fight.
That was really well done. I mean, sure, you get the Wushuang kill, but overall, game talents, I mean, Gimgoon coming in from the flank as well as Republic, that is so hard to deal with, especially since Gimgoon does a lot of damage. As his ulti, even though he doesn't build any damage, here we go.
Flash snare onto Zed. They try to secure the kill, and they find it with a big crit bullet from Zubin. Don't know if they'll have enough to finish off the turret as Mako is back up and Fire Loli can try to land a big cocoon to answer back. And the turret is still standing.
They couldn't kill Ryze on the flank. That was the biggest, that was the major error there. The moment Ryze came in, and let's just watch that once again, because Kim, Wushuang gets a little kill. He was unfortunate there. But let's just watch this Gimgoon and Republic coming in from the flank. Scout recognized this. He died fairly early because he could not handle it. Republic was actually got the shield off his passive, so he didn't take too much damage from Syndra ulti. And then from this point forward, who is going to kill Republic? Absolutely no one, and Gimgoon's going to make sure of that.
I think you said it earlier. With the Rabadon's build, he can just press R and kill Zubin. He can't do that for Republic right now.
Yeah.
Already got the Negatron Cloak. Already has the Rod of Ages stacking health for him. Seems like game talents are, in fact, not out of this just yet, though it is still a 4,000 gold lead.
That was honestly a fight that EDG could have won. That just comes down to they're going to look at that team fight and recognize how to play it better because the flank wasn't a surety. They were winning out in that entire engage, but the moment their rear was actually just left open, the moment that suddenly Scout was just left to his own devices, you have to be able to reset that fight and say, you know what, okay, you know what? There is no threat in front of us. Zubin is not a threat. So just suddenly you can just turn your entire tank line back into and focus down Republic. That's just what they didn't do that.
EDG are hiding in the bush here, but they do not find a pick opportunity. And even in that looking for a pick, they're sitting much farther back than they were now, respecting game talents a lot more. They can't afford to get themselves flanked by Republic once again if some sort of fight were to break out. Gimgoon himself is also getting rather enormous. Finished the Sunfighters, has got his own spectral visage. Meanwhile, the Edge of Night completed on both AD carries, and the Executioner's Calling picked up for Zet, so he is respecting the healing that Gimgoon can do as well.
Yeah, so overall, I mean, they're just playing a little slower, but I think EDG, they're just saying, okay, let's reset. That fight was bad, we know that, but our setup up until that point was actually perfect. So they should continue to do that. Right now, they're just resetting pressure. Poppy's in the top side. He's actually just clearing as much as he can because he's free to do that. Ooh.
Flash from Mako to dodge away from Wushuang. That was... It was safe.
Yeah.
When you really think about it, like, yes, Malzahar and Lee Sin could have killed Mako before the Mountain Drake spawned. So Mako's game sense keeps himself alive.
Yeah, you recognize that you don't know where Sevoki was, and at top of that, the Q lands, and that means that he's probably dead at that point.
Yeah.
So it's just really well played there. It was just that he should be there with his, the rest of his lineup, like the two-man lineup that was free in the lane should actually help him out in warding. Oh!
Ooh, the arrow catches Zubin.
There we go.
As he walks it off. The Mountain Drake is now being pinged out. Scout starts it, and even Mouse is down there as well. Doesn't have to use his teleport.
The pings are coming through. That's a perfect control ward right there, so that's just Maokai looking to actually get another flank.
Where's he going?
Oh, wait a minute.
Where's he going?
They found him. They know he's there,
oh,
actually.
Oh, they're pinging down onto him.
Suddenly, that's not a free flank anymore.
He's trying to hide in a cardboard box, but this Solid Snake has been discovered, pinned against the wall, and EDG even clear out the blast cone before locking him down. Meanwhile, the dragon is being cleaned up by Game Talents, and like bandits in the night,
get
it, and they get out.
So suddenly it's like, wait, where was the Earth Dragon? It was here just this moment ago. But that's a big Maokai gone.
Ooh.
30 seconds. That just means that EDG are going to look for this. They have a Poppy. That means they can actually tank out this Baron. They can look to make this play. This is a smart play from EDG.
They clear out the ward, and now they're going to start working on the dragon. With one Mountain Drake, they're going to do some damage here. Wushuang is over the wall. Still has his smite, level 12 to level 11. And Fire Lolly, as you said, below half health. It's down to 2,000. They try to clear it out, and
there
they eject Wushuang. That is Baron picked up by EDG. I raise your Mountain Drake and take one Baron.
Yeah, you know what? GT thought, you know what? Okay, sure, the flank didn't work out well. But we can take a dragon for a Maokai. That's fine. That's all fair. Suddenly, we deny them the double Earth Dragon. We get ourselves an Earth Dragon. Suddenly, you know what? We lost our major tank. That is actually a Baron lost here. So, a bit of an oversight, obviously. But EDG, it was a bit of a mistake from them in the sense that Fire Lolly was taking a lot of damage and Mao should have been looking to tank first. But overall, regardless of that minute point, it was a great play from EDG.
How did they see the teleport?
That's a good question.
Because it doesn't show up on the mini-map. Mm-hmm. You have to actually be looking with your screen around that area of the map. So that means that somebody was scanning around behind them just to keep an eye on it, because there wasn't any wards there.
They must have recognized it. I mean, Maokai was in the top wave.
They have vision of him casting?
I think so. That's something to look back on. But he definitely was clearing the top wave and then backed away. So they recognized the TP play was coming through. That's something to look back on. But that was a really smart play from EDG overall, and playing back and recognizing this. We got flanked once in this game. We don't want that to happen again.
Fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, game over.
Fool me, can't get fooled again. My favorite Bush quote.
Okay.
Favorite one.
Meanwhile, EDG used that Baron buff now to set up a 4-1 Gimgoon. Unfortunately, not matching it means that the top tier 2 goes down as EDG rotate up and lock it down. Scout preps a whole bunch of orbs in case he needs to kill himself a carry.
This is a long walk coming from Maokai. He was in the wrong lane, obviously, so now this the poke coming down from EDG is coming in quite free. Now he's actually pressuring this flank side, so EDG have to respect it, but he needs to be in the right place. He actually needs to look to stop them from poking. He needs to be by the tower.
Republic trying to clear out that minion wave. Gimgoon being zoned away by Mouse as Wushuang takes just a little bit of poke. They're continuing to heal up, and EDG have got that Ocean Drake.
Mouse is playing his role really well. He recognized the flank pressure coming in from Gimgoon. He's just saying, you know what? I'm going to be the sole person that just backs you away. So Zed's taking a lot of damage, but they can continue down this path because Zed doesn't actually have to auto the turret.
Slowly whittling away at that turret. Gimgoon waiting on the side. It's close.
It's a lot of cannon minions.
And there it goes. Finally breaking down. EDG start moving forward with that wave, looking now for the inhibitor. They've still got Baron for about 30 seconds or so.
This is a full committal from them because they don't have the waves in either mid or bottom lane. They're going for it.
Gimgoon drops the ultimate, gets in on the Mouse, who immediately knocks him back away. Chain of Corruption catches two as Gimgoon is eating a lot of the damage, but they are able to drop Savoki on the side. Scout cleanses, but drops to Republic once again. The inhib goes down, but the curtain does as well. They're looking for Zed. Heal is enough to keep him standing, and EDG kite it out and walk away.
There we go. I mean, they lost Scout in the entire ordeal, but that's a fine takeaway. You get the inhib, you get the tower, and the inhib, I mean. That's a major win from EDG.
Indeed it is. 8-8 and an 8,000 gold lead. Tragically not 8 turrets though, but I'm sure EDG are certainly working on it. Game Talents now find themselves at an inhib disadvantage. Look at those wards by the fallen inhib.
Yeah. That's
EDG
a lot of wards.
EDG were so ready for that.
That's
holy
a lot
cow.
Of wards. But one big point to take away from this, because that's the top lane in Hibdown, and the dragon is coming up. That's an infernal dragon in about a minute. EDG can just take a free one. Now, that's actually incredibly free, because Maokai, sure, he has TP, but if he actually, he needs to tend to the top wave, because if he TPs a little bit too early without having to deal with it, that just means that, you know, suddenly you have super minions in your tower.
We already talked about this. Fool me once, shame on you.
Yep.
Fool me twice, I'm not playing Maokai again.
There's no control ward this time. Suddenly he can't make that mistake anymore.
Oh,
he can't do it.
Rip.
So I like that control ward. Mouse, I was a big fan of it.
Yeah, Mouse is now heading towards the top side. They did clear out the ward.
Yeah.
Heading towards the top side to expedite the process. Realm Warp brings in Republic and Savoki, who immediately just take a little bit of damage, a little bit of regret.
That was a little bit interesting. Of course, you couldn't get it. They were looking for something. That was a bit of a stretch, especially since now that they've lost the Ryze ulti, EDG can just reset pressure. They're like, you know what? Suddenly you have a massive wave coming into your top lane tower. So you have to deal with that. This is a free tower. It's either a free tower or Game Talents lose the game.
Here comes Game Talents. They might try to fight this out as they clear out the minion wave. Defending it, super minions are continuing to press into the top side. Mouse trying to pull Gimgun's attention by pressuring multiple locations. And with that, Wushuang and Republic pull back along with Zubin. And as you said, Mr. Raz Laplasm, it is, in fact, a free turret.
Yeah, there we go. So they're able to take it. That's just persistence overall. They recognize they're in a good place. Now they're going to go for this next turret. That's a lot of poke coming in from Zed and a lot of setup from Scout. There's no way that they lose out in this situation. And of course, the super minion is still at the top lane base, so someone's going to have to deal with that.
Mm-hmm. Getting inexorably closer to that Nexus turret, Republic heals himself up at the fountain before polishing off the rest of those super minions to let his wave try to push back out, but he has to stay close to his team in the event that EDG try to make something happen.
This is when they're pressuring in. This is going to be the point where they actually look to take this. Game Towns, they should look for something. All right.
Wushuang gets in and out. Whoa.
I don't know what he was trying to bait out. He probably thought he got a kick on the champion.
Just want to make sure you're paying attention. All right, so
that's
they take down
for the day.
Yeah, they take down the inhibitor turret, leave the inhibitor standing before falling back for the Infernal Drake. Baron is up in 20 seconds. EDG have got some time to go for a quick five-man recall. All in unison, they do. And Wushuang now going to use that Ranger Smite to secure some vision as he tries to clear out Scuttlecrab. Die faster! There he goes.
So he still has a second Smite saved up. The second one's coming up, and that's going to be really important. Simply because this Baron is an inevitability. Oh, you know what? I'm just going to stop attempting for it. I'm trying so hard. An inevitability. There we go.
It is.
It's inevitable. There we go. Four times I think I attempted that one overall.
The ultimate eventuality.
They tried. So this needs to be a steal. They can't commit numbers to it simply because the top lane inhib is still a thing. And I feel, yeah, Ryze is going to be able to deal with it. He still has his ulti, so he's going to be able to come back and come into the team fight. They definitely need Maokai in the fight overall. He needs to be able to lead his team towards to get that vision behind the pit. EDG are not going to allow them, though.
Game Talents trying to keep an eye on EDG and deny this Baron attempt. Zubin, despite being down about 70 CS, is still 2-1-4. He's been able to come back rather well as Gimgun flashes over the wall to engage on the Mako. Fire Lolly on the side, Mouse in the front. He's going to deny any more curtains from being called. Scout tries to get away, but the tanks lock him down. Mouse is buying so much time, and two tanks go down for one. The Guardian Angels refresh at almost exactly the same time. Mouse flashes away, and EDG take two and lose none.
Yeah, that's an easier win for them simply because Wushuang thought he can assassinate Scout. Scout just flashed over the wall overall, so he's just in a safe space. Now they have five members strong looking for this Baron. They should be able to get it.
Trying to burn through its health. They've got one Mountain Drake. Wushuang is dead. Ooh. Captive Audience does not do it for Game Talents. His Baron is secured. Uh-oh. I feel like we just saw a very deadly game of Red Rover. Mako, goes down.
Team?
To Republic, question mark? Ping? Yo, Flash over the cocoon. Firewall Republic.
Wait a minute.
Doing work here. Mouse on the side is now trying to deal with Savoki, but has to run away from the Liandry's.
Oh.
20 health.
Yeah, he regened a little bit too, so he probably like had a good 18, something around there. So just watch this a little bit. That was a really good engage from Gimgoon, but overall, you know, we're trading tanks here. Gimgoon's here. Yeah. Poppy's on the other, zoning off three members. But just take a look at Wushuang here, because they're really trying hard to get the kill on Scout. The Scout flashes over the wall, is in such a safe space. The two GAs coming up. Who's going to get it first? But Mouse instantly flashes out, so he's actually at a safe space.
Mm-hmm. It's like trading cards. I'll give you my Maokai and my Lee Sin for your Poppy. Deal. I regret this trade.
That's not an even trade at all.
No.
That's not what I was looking for.
Though it is 10 to 10, it's still about an 11,000 gold lead for EDG overall. They are definitely getting the better out of this card deal. They've got all the holographics, all of the gold cards.
I will say, though, as a big point, is that I haven't really played a trading card game in my life.
Really? Not a single one?
Not a single one.
Magic the Gathering, Pokemon the Trading Card Game, Yu-Gi-Oh, Hearthstone.
I had a few Pokemon cards, only like two, because people just gave it to me randomly. So I never really actually committed to playing Pokemon, because much like cigarettes, it's an addiction, and it costs a lot to keep it up.
You can't compare Pokemon the Trading Card Game to nicotine.
I'm doing it anyway.
That costs a lot of money. Mouse is going to eat some damage, but EDG collapse. And they say trading card games are dangerous, kids. Make sure to consult your parents first so you don't get addicted.
There we go.
As long as you aren't Razzleplasm.
Yep. Gimgun's now. TP's coming through.
Probably fine.
I'm going to save face here at that point.
Did you just try to use the moderation argument? Too much of card games is a bad thing because it's too much.
I mean, you just have to commit a lot of money to
it. Oh, my God.
You just have to. You do. Just putting that out there.
Oh, my God. This is amazing. I've got to cast another series after this. I can't lose it. Stay focused, Dumb. Okay.
But yeah, Gimgoon is down. That was another inhib is lost. Overall, I'm just looking at game talents, and it looks like a bit of a lost cause. They need to force another fight. They tried, but of course, your tank is out.
But at that point, that was 20 minutes ago. EDG have cleaned up those mistakes, and they haven't allowed game talents to make any more of those openings available.
Yeah, but the possibility still exists. Even though Zubin's incredibly far behind, he still has a lot of penetration in his item set. And it's at a point where he is level 16, so it has come a little bit to parity. He's close.
Yep.
It's worthwhile now to have that. He's not going to be able to auto-attack a single member, so that BF sword better turn into another armor penetration item.
Just look for the big hits.
Yeah, he has to set up his team. That's his old role here right now, because it's going to be all Republic and Gimgoon.
Wushuang, maybe. Republic has been going off on Ryze.
He's playing incredibly well.
In game number one, he played well. In game number two, he continued to play well, despite the circumstances of the game. And in here now, in game number three, he's effectively flanking and keeping two or three people occupied while his team does work.
Oh,
and there he
goes
for the flank again. Gimgoon is going to take the journey into the back, has found Mako. Republic follows it up. Exhaust denies some time as Wushuang gets a big kick.
Oh.
They're able to kick Mako out of this as they reject the fight. Mouse is going to be locked down, and game talents are winning the fight here. Mouse is going to go down snared. He's got Flash over the wall and is going to kite it away. They see Mouse running, and he will scurry away back to base. But Elder Dragon is up in 5 seconds, and Game Talents have lost only one member.
That is really a solid defense. That's what they needed to keep themselves back in there, obviously.
They actually did it.
Gimgoon and Republic are playing incredibly well, and they're playing with each other so solidly where it's just that, you know what? Ryze didn't take that TP. He knew that Gimgoon was going to take, and he was going to get into the back line. He followed it through. Let's watch it through, because Republic's saying, I'm going through the front. You're going through the back. Mako's just going to get demolished. Even though the exhaust came through, it's not enough. And if we look at Wushuang's kick, that was a fantastic kick.
Yeah, three-man kick.
Yeah, that was incredibly well done. So Scout goes down. Suddenly, you don't have your jungler anymore.
And Game Talents have taken the Elder Dragon. Is Game Talents going to be the team to defeat EDG?
All right, hold on just a second. Let's not go that far. They're just trying to keep their Nexus in hit turrets up and available.
I mean, you said it yourself. We have to consider the possibility. It's 37 and a half minutes in. Game Talents have now lost one of their Nexus turrets. But regardless of that, they've got the Elder Dragon. They are the late game team fighting team. That's where they have found success in the past.
Yeah. It definitely is. It's a possibility. They have the Elder Dragon. It doesn't last long. So EDG, I mean, this is, if you're EDG right now, you say, let's shrug it off. Right now, Game Talents can't pressure a dang thing. They can't do anything. Right now, they're trying to, but EDG just has to play it patiently and try to kill time before for the Elder Dragon to wear off. You lose this tower. Give it away, Zet. It's not worth it.
They're going to shove forward, taking down that tier one. Zet, not going to take any chances, decides to let it fall. There are still super minions flooding in from the bottom lane. Eventually, Game Talents are going to have to answer that.
They're actually going all in for this.
Yeah, they're continuing. That's a big crit.
They need to go for this right now. I mean, they're trying really hard. Stunned. But that bottom lane is a ticking time bomb for Game Talents. So they either play hard and get that tower, or they lose an inhib. And the TP is just about to come available for Mouse. So that split push is available for them.
Meanwhile, Scout clearing out that minion wave on the bottom. Very close to full build. Republic on the other side is in fact full build. Very tanky as he spices in the Guardian Angel along with the Abyssal Scepter.
That's going to be so annoying to deal with. You got double Guardian Angel from both Maokai and the Ryze. The two players who have been just raging havoc into the back line of your team. This is going to be really difficult for EDG.
The challenge is on. They might have waited just a little bit too long with that early advantage that they had. And now,
props to Zubin. Honestly, even though he's been taking it for the majority of the game, he's back in it and he's almost full build as well.
He is indeed taking his time. Still down a healthy number of CS, but at this point it doesn't even matter. Baron has respawned. EDG are on this side of the map.
This is when the poke from Zet actually starts to not matter as much. And here we go.
Oh, they managed to catch Savoki and they kill him almost immediately.
I think Savoki was the only one that took that Ryze hit, ulti.
Rip Remor.
What was he doing? You're a bit too creative there. Could have just let it go. This is definitely going to be a start of Baron for EDG. Savoki is not too crucial to this fight. So they can actually, Game Talents can get away with starting this fight here.
Yeah, they're trying to burn through. Gimgun is in the front, and he gets shredded down. The Guardian Angel is popped, and EDG are moving past. Republic eats the Unleashed Power as the curtain call goes wide. Zet is trying to kite back behind the carry as Zubin is forced to cancel. Wushuang gets kited and cleared out. Republic retreating. His Guardian Angel is popped. Gimgun going to die. Zubin, it's now or never, buddy, because you're 1v5, and EDG will maintain their winning streak unless Zubin gets a miracle stop.
Oh, there is nothing Zubin and Savoki can do at this point. That's a massive wave coming in. TP as well from Mouse. This is over.
Yeah, getting to the back before Zubin even can. Savoki has respawned in the meanwhile, and Mouse is going to try to bully him down. He's eating a lot of damage here. There's the flash arrow. And Chain of Corruption is going to be popped, and EDG will be able to take this. Despite being on the verge, the very edge itself, they maintain their undefeated regional win streak. The last time they lost was to the Shaogu Reapers, March 12th, 2016.
Hmm. That's interesting.
This almost,
team,
yeah.
We definitely thought they would lose a game. I mean, so far we're still in week two, so that anything could happen. They just faced WE last week, week one, and they couldn't lose that one. So let's just see what's happening.
They ended up not losing that one. but joining us once again on the desk is Zach Rusty Pie. EDG, they brought it back.
Yeah, EDG started the game extremely well. They looked like it was a complete simple closeout. There was absolutely no chance for Game Talents in the third game to even look at a semblance of a comeback. It felt like Game 2 was repeating itself all over again.
Yeah.
But not to be. Somehow, Game Talents showed some unique resilience in the ability to play League of Legends and overwhelmed time and again EDG with good decision-making and full team committal moves. Up until 40 minutes where Savoki took a journey and the rest of the team said no way and then asked why he took it.
Yeah, yeah. I want to listen to cons of that one. See what Savoki was like. Yeah, you know what?
Guys, I really need to use the bathroom. Can we just end it here?
That was something. I think Game Talents played their team fights incredibly well as the game started to go a little bit awry for them. Republic and Gimgun just played their flanks incredibly. I love the Ryze ultis coming through constantly.
Yeah, I will say the shining light to me of the team of Game Talents is the members that you highlighted. There was some nice kicks from Wushuang. Like, the bottom lane was okay as we hit the mid game. They were still doing the fights well, like long range, just complementary stuff. But between the mid laner of Ryze, the ultimates that he was getting Gimgoon into, and the tankiness that like Gimgoon was for the team, like, those two were the MVP performers of a losing series. Mm-hmm. But it's still a very big positive to take away, because losing to EDG is expected, and they made it so much harder for EDG to win than it should have been.
Yeah, and honestly, that's just a win for Game Talents as a team, as a org, to really recover from last week. That last week they got blown out. this time they went up against EDG, not expected to win, and they were able to at least come out and make it competitive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they will be playing against, I believe it's WE later this week. So the challenge is certainly set for Game Talents. If they could make it hard for a team like EDG, despite effectively throwing a game, odds look good.
I mean, odds potentially look even better for them against WE, because they are late-game team fighters, and they're going to be playing against late-game team fighters that have preferences to go into that stage of the game. So, like, matchup-wise, if you were to give the underdogs the ability to beat one team, it's either that or perhaps Vici. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Kind of take it to them.
That's the thing, because actually their game this week should be up against Vici.
You're right. It is against Vici game.
So, going up against Vici, I think that it's going to be a better performance from them, or at least a better look from Game Talents. They looked good here. From game, I mean, good with an asterisk, obviously.
Yes.
But it's looked like they can play competitively, and going up against Vici has some holes in their pockets.
Sure.
Maybe they can try and get something going.
The big question was, can Game Talents improve on what they saw success with at the end of the split last year? Mm-hmm. So far, it seems like the answer is yes, and that means that this is a team that could continue to survive.
Yes, that's true. But with that being said, their success might be limited, because making playoffs in this group is going to be really tough. So even though that last year it was a little easier for them, they were in a better group. This time, lighty luck is not in their favor.
Oh, yeah. EDG, WE, Vici, Xiaogu.
Yeah.
It's just generally an impossible group for them to get out of. Like, let's be honest. We came into this when we saw the group draw. It was done world style, where they based performances off last year. And you're like, okay, no matter what happens, we know they're going to get picked in towards the end of the draw. And they just happened to get QG that came up, and it looked like a really good team. They just happened to get the reinvigorated, you know, Vici and everything in this side. Yeah. So the stars did not align for GT. They did the opposite.
Do we call this the new EDG then, from the departure of Pawn and Deft? Or is this still the same EDG with fresher parts?
I actually think they still play towards the same style, right? Scout is still is actually a bigger focus. Mm-hmm. But with that being said, Zet and Mako are playing so well, and they're just playing towards that advantage. Now they're literally just playing towards bot side. Sure, there was that Elise game where he was playing towards Mouse, and Mouse is starting to perform a little bit better. So now that I'm looking at EDG, sure, they have more tools that they can play towards. Plays towards Scout, play towards possibly Coral 1 and Mouse, but their bottom lane just looks too good.
I think bringing back Koro is still a positive in the end. Mouse is showing that he's improving more and more, but Koro is the one who has the highest ceiling, I believe, out of the two. And Zet is a big proponent on what the new EDG will look like, but the new EDG looks like the old EDG, like, in all seriousness, when they get to that stage. So, like, when you say they've hit their peak or they've hit the mark on where they want to be, it's because they look the exact same as where they left it when they had Deft as their AD carry. And Deft is a god who you'd have to say they're hurting of losing.
Yeah. MVP, though, they are going to give it to Mako in that game. 1-4-3 overall. Looks like he got 17.5% of his kills. Not quite a great number for a support, but still pretty good performance.
I mean, Mako is just a very consistent support overall. He plays towards lane. I mean, their laning phase was godly. And then he just plays towards constantly setting down vision with his team. And his vision control, even though sometimes it was predictable in the sense that Game Talents were like, this is the right position for him to be. And so they got picks off him. But because it's the right position for them to be, they were just a completely consistent team in getting to the objectives that they were looking for.
Mm-hmm. Well, it certainly was a very good performance for EDG as a whole, and Game Talent still showing that they can compete as well. Looking forward then, what are we expecting for Game Talents moving into the rest of the week? I mean, obviously, we said they're playing against Vici. Mm. Do they continue to play around Wushuang? Do they try to close their weaknesses in the bottom lane?
So we spoke towards what their strengths were already, right? Which was their mid laner and their top laner. I think Wushuang in the first game when they actually took down EDG still looked like another positive, and I think that's the area they should focus on the most. I mean, at the end of the day, like the LPL has two different types of teams. There's the ones that win through bottom lane, the ones that don't and pretend bottom lane doesn't exist.
Yeah.
I think Game Talents is one of those ones that disregards the bottom lane entirely as a unit. It's just like, you guys hang out and try not to die a lot. Like, IG does the same thing, legitimately ignores them and says, try your best. Like, have fun. Participation medals for you guys. We're going to carry on the top side of the map. And so that's the big thing that's missing for me now for GT is the jungle position, because bottom lane's irrelevant and mid and top were playing well.
Yeah, that's the thing. You get a lot of planes, and this is the same with Chagu in that they have Alone and Ali, and they have the same, essentially the same identity, but they can play without pressure fairly well and still CS well. The thing with the bottom lane here in Game Towns, they're giving them really impossible lanes here, and that they're saying, well, you were already performing poorly when you had semi-decent lanes, but now you're given an impossible lane, and it just feels so hard for them to actually survive before the level 5 point.
No, I agree, and like being against the Varus Misfortune when we already saw priority from EDG onto Varus, we know that Misfortune with Varus is absolutely dirty, because like an 80% slow and a Varus charging up, it's very rarely going to miss.
It's not going to miss.
Very few contexts with which that actually doesn't hit.
Yeah, and so they do it the dirtiest way too. Varus ducks into brush, and then Mako starts going forward, and you're like, I guess I know what's coming.
You can't stop it. You actually just can't, especially since you know Fire Lolly's just in their back pocket. It's the clear love effect, and it's just in place.
Yeah, so I feel like bottom lane perhaps could be drafted better for, but overall it should be the jungle. And like, again, against EDG, they should have acknowledged perhaps coming into the third game more about the drafting phase in particular, what should have been changed, acknowledging that the bans could have been perhaps a Varus. Like, blue side EDG first picked it. It was obvious, it was acknowledged, it has happened to them already, but they just were confident and made a mistake.
It's too hard, especially if you're on red side, because there's so many bans that you have to go through. So Varus, it's like, I guess we have to give this away. So I mean, you just really need blue side. That's the tail of the tape here. You can't give them blue. You can't give anybody blue side. Which, you need to take it.
To be fair, weirdly enough, they won on red side.
Yeah,
and so that's perhaps where a lot of the potential salt or annoyance from Game Talents will arise. They won on red. They had this strategy and it worked, and then they lost on blue, and that's gotta hurt.
Yeah, it certainly does. We're going to go ahead and take a quick break. Don't go anywhere. We're going to be right back with our match of the week, Xiaogu versus Vici Gaming.